Research ethics process and principles is about ensuring that you've got the best quality research that you can plan for. Now, we never know how it will work out, but we can plan to do research as well as we possibly can. And the research process, ethics process, is part of that, if you like, quality control or quality management, which I think is probably a better term. So it's there to support you, it's there to help you. There are some obligations which I'll refer to very briefly. But please see this as a supportive, facilitative process. So it is about you, it's about your research, and the ethics committees are in the university here to support you as researchers, to support your students as researchers or learners. By the way, we're not talking about ethics in terms of a moral code. I'm not a bishop or a religious, if you like, an ethical sort of leader in that sort of moral sense. We're really actually talking about a set of principles which underlie good practice, good behaviour. And so, if you like, it's a sort of secular version of morality, but it's really not a moral code. So I do have occasional discussions with people puzzling over how a committee or how an individual can actually comment on the morality of a piece of research. And please, we're not doing that. We're really trying to evaluate a proposal for research against a set of standards. And these are really the standards that, at least in the Anglophone world, largely we take to be the standards for good behaviour at a sort of personal and a social level. The usual question, when do we actually need to use it? It's really simple. Whenever you're engaging people in some way in your research, that's what human research is. Now, the old traditional one is that we'll have a pile of subjects. These are either anonymous people answering a survey, or they're people in a hospital bed that we want to poke things in to test how they respond to medication or to some surgical something or other. But it's in fact much broader than that. And most of the research here at Southern Cross University tends to be fairly benign. It tends to be social in nature. There's elements of cultural research. There's a little bit of intervention, experimental work. But we are largely engaging people, looking at how they go about their daily lives, how they go about their professional lives, what their views and opinions about things are, how they respond to social stimuli, for example. So it's the breadth, width and breadth of social sciences, which is really our primary interest. And oddly enough, when I go and visit other universities, you realise that we have this body of expertise and comfort with that arena of research. Other universities find it quite troublesome because they're used to the more experimental end of research. So any time that we're surveying people, whether that's formal surveys, online or offline, whether it's focus groups, discussions, stopping and talking to people in the street, working with what we might call key informants, specialists who, you know, have a particular role in society and their business in as professional people. Any form of engagement is human research. It may be passive observation, and there's lots of ways that can be done. It can be done quite explicitly. You may be embedded in an organization. You may be taking part in activities. You may be removed from them. Again, if you're observing people's behavior, that's human research. There is a little bit of experimental work. The psychologists do a lot of perception and a psychological experimentation, often using computer programs, asking people to respond to particular stimuli and looking at what those responses look like. We have a little bit of clinical trials, especially in the naturopathy area, where we're looking at people engaging in trialing supplements. These are often very formalized, very structured experiments that come out of that tradition of clinical experimentation. There's action learning, action research, community engagement. The list can go on, but basically, if you're engaging people, that's human research. And you should think about whether you need human research ethics application. People who are engaged in our research are participants. And we have to remember something very, very fundamental. Nobody actually needs us. Now, that may seem a bit bold to say, but you know, most of the public never need to meet an academic in their life. They'll get on happily, they'll live their lives, well, maybe not happily, but they don't need to actually engage us ever. We need them because our job, part of our job description is to create new knowledge. And how do we do that? We observe the world, we collect data, and if we're in the area that involves people, we have to engage people. We need them for our degrees, for our papers, to complete our projects, but they don't need to ever come in contact with us. We create reasons why it's good for them to do it, and they will, if they involve themselves with us, probably get a good feeling, a soft, cuddly feeling that they're doing us some good. They're engaging in something which might be quite interesting. Most research gives almost nothing back to the participants at point of contact. And it's actually very hard to find ways of doing that. There are ways of doing it. I have a PhD student now that's doing that quite deliberately, looking at the survey design in order to give point of contact feedback. But that's rare. It's very rare. So we need to remember that our participants are there out of the goodness of their heart. We need to respect that. We need to make sure that we don't do them any harm, that we give them as much positive as we can. And we need to look after them, protect them. So that's what the research ethics process does. It partly does is asking us to protect our participants. Now, these participants aren't just the people giving us information or sharing information, giving us their stories. They are ourselves. They are our research assistants. They are the people around us. And we often forget that the research we do can affect ourselves as researchers, and we've got to look after ourselves. The very basic workplace health and safety principle. If we're uncomfortable, if we're stressed, if we're at risk, we do not do our job well. So we know that if we come into a place where, and you hear stories of people coming in and they're anxious because they think another colleague's going to say something about them, or they're anxious because the lab that they're working in is smelly and they're worried about the chemicals, they don't work well. And this applies here. If we do research and we're putting ourselves in a risk, we're reducing the quality of our life, we're reducing the quality of our work, and ultimately we're reducing the capacity for our research to yield good outcomes. We have to protect our institution. As I said, we are licensed. If we as researchers misbehave, if we do shoddy research, it's a wonderful piece of beat up for the press. Wouldn't they love to have another go at the universities because look what this one researcher's doing. Very simple little things. We had, I'll give you a really simple example. We had a researcher doing biopsies on dolphins a few years ago now. It's a really simple technique, little bit of skin, they can get do chemistry and genetics on them. How do you get them? There's a very simple little dart gun that you use that dolphin doesn't notice. It falls off in the water, you pull it back with a piece of string and there's a little bit of skin there and they can do their chemistry and their biochemistry on it. Unfortunately, you don't stand on the main beach of Byron Bay with what looks like a rifle shooting at dolphins. Yes. It's not the smartest thing to do. It's not unethical, it's just dumb. But it caused quite a public response, and you can imagine. And it's very easy for us to do that without thinking. And hopefully, again, the ethics approval process helps you think through some of those things. And planning is everything. Time spent planning, just thinking, what are the tripwires? What are the things we shouldn't do? That one was sorted, but you know, it wasn't the smartest thing to do. So you can see that the institution, of course, that person, nobody knows who they are. They are the university. And so the university gets tagged with that slightly unthoughtful activity. Yeah. Yeah, it's not what we like to be known for. Okay. The other side of it, of course, is, as you're getting from me, we're facilitating quality research, we're helping you. And a great deal of what I do is talk about research long before it comes to the committee. Probably half of my time, maybe more actually now, is just talking about research, which I love doing. And it gives me a little vicarious pleasure to talk about everybody's research. Some of you will know that I tend to work right across the disciplines. So I've got this sort of interest. I get bored easily, so I like to hear about other people's research and disciplines I've never heard about. And I've worked in the cultural theory end of things. I've worked in the geosciences. I have a fairly good understanding of research across the board, and I just enjoy talking about it. And the more you talk about your research with people, the more ideas get matured and you get new ideas. And, you know, that's... talking with people, sitting, having a cup of coffee in the corridors in your tea rooms, just sort of sounding out ideas is enormously powerful. And we do it in the context of the research ethics principles. And what we then end up with, and I've watched this over the years, the quality of the applications coming to the committee have been improving. The number of ones that we're having to knock back, well, we very rarely do, but we have to work further on. And the ones that we have to work further with are the ones that haven't been discussed. They've come off, they've been rushed, they've been done without somebody talking with a supervisor. It's quite clear what the pattern is. So discussing it, talking it, take that opportunity. And I do a lot of that to help. And the committee will help as well. We may actually send suggestions back. We've got experts there that quite often will stand up and say, look, I'm happy to go and have a chat with this person because this is something I know about. And we'll be able to help them redesign it so it really works well.